We're going to start soon. Ooh, wow, this is loud. We're going to start soon. Can you take your seat, please? Thank you. Ready. Come on. What do we have to do? Quiet. Sit down and dream guys, so. Good evening, everyone. I'm Sandy Ploton, and on behalf of the Center on Disabilities at California State University Northridge, I would like to officially welcome you to the 33rd Annual Assistive Technology CSUN Conference. And I had that backwards. Even though I promise not to repeat the same thing every year at the keynote, I'm under contractual obligations to do so, so bear with me. I'm sure you know that this event is the largest, longest running, and only university-sponsored event of its kind. You know that we are valuable and rewarding for newcomers, that we have the best researchers, consumers, practitioners, government representatives, great speakers, and amazing exhibitors. And I think we can all agree that the CSUN conference is the best venue for networking. I'm sure that everyone wants to hear about Anaheim, and if you don't know, that's where the conference is moving in 2019. Oh no, what? You'll love it, trust me. All in one place, one hotel. We're the only game in town. Exhibitors and sponsors, rest assured, we'll be contacting you after this year's event wraps up and we've had some time to debrief. When the social hub opens tomorrow in this room, we'll have a display where you can get some general information, and it's also available on Daisy now. Speaking of information, I'd like you to bear with me for a minute because I want to give you a little suggestion. If you want the most accurate information about the conference, you should really sign up for the mailing list. We don't inundate you with a lot of emails. Or go to our website and read the information that's there, or check our social media. We have seen a few non-CSUN conference posts and tweets, and sometimes they don't actually have the right information, and we don't want our participants to be misled or confused. So if you could do us all a favor, we do love you retweeting, but please start at the source and get your conference news from CSUN. It will save us all a lot of time and inconvenience. Thank you. This has been a public service announcement from the Center on Disabilities. Now, let me introduce Karen Sachs, because I said I wasn't going to talk long, this year's conference chair and host for tonight's program. Dr. Karen Sachs is professor and chair of the Department of Administration, Rehabilitation, and Post-Secondary Education and director of the InterWork Institute at San Diego State University. In addition to teaching in a rehabilitation counseling master's degree program and a doctorate of education, educational leadership, community college, leadership concentration, she also administers a post-baccalaureate certificate in rehabilitation technology and the supported employment and transition specialist certificate. In what I guess is her spare time as director of the InterWork Institute, Karen oversees more than $5 million annually in grants and contracts funded through federal and state resources, which are then all channeled through a very long list of programs that are working with assistive technology and people with disabilities. Karen's commitment to working in these fields started when she began her career as a special education and transition teacher. I don't think it was that long ago, right? Because we're about the same age. Anyway, Karen is a valuable colleague, collaborator, and friend. So please join me in welcoming our 2018 CSUN Conference Chair, Dr. Karen Sachs.
Thank you, Sandy. I'd like to welcome everybody and welcome back. For those of you who've been here, some of us have been regulars at this conference for many years, or in some cases, decades. And we look forward to seeing our old friends and to meeting new colleagues. As Sandy said, this is a wonderful place to network, share ideas, and make plans for future collaboration. This conference attracts people with a wide variety of skills, experiences, interests, and goals for coming here. Please take advantage of the time to get to know each other at the reception tonight, during the breaks throughout the conference, while you're exploring the exhibit hall, and after sessions have ended for the day. While we're all here to celebrate technology, talking to real people in real time makes for real relationships, so take advantage of that. So as Sandy mentioned, this is our last conference in San Diego. We're kind of sorry to see it go. We didn't plan any fireworks or parades or flyovers, which is what we usually do around here, but we're guessing that our keynote speaker, Dan Goldstein, may provoke some dialogue and discussion and give us plenty to think about. So recently retired, Dan was the founding partner of Brown, Goldstein, and Levy in Baltimore. Dan's love of trial work led to a wide-ranging practice that included complex commercial matters, high-impact public interest litigation, personal injury, white-collar criminal defense, and many more. As counsel for the National Federation of the Blind for more than two decades, Dan initiated a national legal campaign to ensure access to technology, including websites, ATMs, and voting machines. His work went beyond litigation to facilitating partnerships, including the negotiation of joint technology agreements with major technology developers. In 2011, Dan received the American Bar Association's Paul G. Hearn Award for Disability Rights, which is presented each year to an individual who has made significant contributions to further the rights, dignity, and access to justice for people with disabilities. More recently, in 2016, Dan was honored by the National Federation of the Blind with the Kenneth Jernigan Significant Contributions to the Blindness Community. The president of NFB commented, "Blind Americans have made progress during the past 30 years due to the skill, imagination, heart, and commitment of Dan Goldstein and his work with the NFB." Please welcome Dan Goldstein.
I'll see if I can come up with some fireworks. I am very honored to deliver the keynote at this, the 33rd annual CSUN Conference on Accessible Technology. But I am disappointed and more than a little sad that there needs to be a 33rd annual conference. Accessibility aside, what in technology takes 33 years? It's not that I'm impatient that technology is taking so long. I might be able to live with that. It's rather, sadly, that I'm convinced we're losing ground, that technology is developing and proliferating more rapidly than accessibility is diffusing into the technology world. If the title weren't already taken, this speech would be called An Inconvenient Truth. We're not just grappling with how to make sure that next year's technology is accessible when it comes on the market. We're still faced with addressing the continuing inaccessibility of a World Wide Web that is celebrating its 29th birthday. A great, 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 great grandfather in technology generations. For the most part, the technological solutions to accessibility are known, if not universally used. For many technologies, the accessibility solutions predated the technologies. ATMs are a good example, kiosks are another. So I suggest we need to stop going about business as usual, at least for a bit, because business as usual is leaving us further behind. And at least stop long enough to ask why, after 33 years, isn't virtually all digital technology accessible when it comes to market? How do we motivate the adoption of accessibility so that accessibility, like its younger cousin security, is seen as a mandatory feature? Why is accessibility not yet the norm for websites, employee-facing software, employee training videos, phone apps, kiosks, and POS machines? Are there reasons to lead us to believe that accessibility, accessibility will be the norm by the 35th annual CSUN conference, by the 40th, at the 50th? I don't think so, unless we understand why we have not succeeded in 33 years. How long is 33 years in tech development? After CSUN began, Oracle went public, the internet was born, Facebook, Google, Epic, and Amazon all came to be after this conference started working. Yet, Oracle partners and Oracle tools certification do not require knowledge of how to maintain the accessibility of a product that Oracle has made accessible. Blind workers in the healthcare industry can't use most functions of Epic software. Amazon not only continues to offer new and accessible products, and Peter Korn told me earlier today, one of them, either Amazon lockers or Amazon kiosks, is now accessible, but promising accessibility as a later add-on doesn't cut it. The motto of the disability community is not later is better than never. And Amazon continues to use employment assessment tests and on-the-job software that are inaccessible. Now, we often say that accessibility isn't rocket science. At some point, probably everybody in this room has said that at least once. I wish it were. Wernher von Braun only took 27 years to go from lobbing V1 rockets at London to putting a man on the moon. So if accessibility were rocket science, we would have had the last CSUN conference 6 years ago, and inaccessible technology would have gone the way of floppy disks. Now, it's true the 100 Years' War took longer, the 30 Years' War took less, so did the 7 Years' War, and of course, there was the 6 Day War. When it comes to technical solutions to accessibility, we have some of the smartest people in the world. You're going to hear from one after me, Richard Ladner, and also Ray Kurzweil, Jim Thatcher, Judy Brewer, George Kirscher. I mean, I could go on and on. So the problem, I suggest, is not a lack of technical expertise or that accessibility is inherently difficult. We must confront the possibility that we have not correctly analyzed the problem and thus need to redirect at least some of our energies. That we are, in effect, providing the answer 3 inches to the question, what color is an orange? We need to speak about this with frankness and urgency. So I polled a number of people, some of whom are in this room, and all of whom will remain anonymous, asking them, like the child in the back seat, why aren't we there yet? I will share some of those answers and then offer my own thoughts on the nature of the problem and at least one way to address it. If these analyses are off base, then discard them. and offer your own, because this is a conversation that's urgently needed. I hope at some future CSUN there can be a town hall just devoted to why aren't we there yet and what do we need to do to get there. There's, of course, no single cause, no single answer. Not all answers are obtainable, and not all have equal impact. But I talked to an academic in tech access issues, and he offered the following. He said, we're going to have an accessibility as long as students in computing don't learn about accessibility and don't see peers with disabilities. He acknowledged that teach access and access computing are working on each of these problems. Now, for my part, I agree these are desirable steps, but they're not new thoughts. I think I first talked to Judy Brewer about could this be part of an MIT curriculum when she was a teenager. And I suspect that accessibility will not be a required part of a degree program until there is a greater market demand for accessibility. This academic went on to say that university systems should be required to report every year on their accessibility, as they do with a Cleary report on campus crime statistics and related policies. To that I say, it would be delicious if that happened. Transparency would help, but the political climate for the foreseeable future makes the idea of required reporting on accessibility seem, delusional? Nonetheless, there is a seed there worth thinking about. Is there some kind of voluntary self-reporting by someone, perhaps corporations, not colleges, that could be stimulated, something like the LEED standard for architects? Some of you are probably thinking, we already have lots of technical standards. That's not what I mean. Just be patient. I'll tell you what my thought is. Now, this academic's third point was that ADA regulations on web accessibility would help a lot. Perhaps that would make a difference, but that requires regime change in this country. And then when there is a new administration, it may not be any more at the top of that new administration's agenda than it was at the top of President Obama's agenda. I talked to another academic activist who focused on why the web in particular is inaccessible, though she did not offer a solution. I have paraphrased, I hope accurately, her fabulous analysis as follows. We sometimes forget that the web really started around 1994. By the time W3C had their first set of guidelines out in 1996, we were just at the beginning of a truly ubiquitous use. Netscape Navigator and Hotmail. Google was in beta, Amazon had just been born. Yet we only had about 100,000 websites. As of today, we have a hair under 4.5 billion web pages. So in the beginning, we knew we needed to educate a finite group of web designers and developers. Then the web literally blew up in front of us, and the task of creating awareness and training for accessibility changed dramatically. Currently, just about anybody can put content up on the web, whether it's selling on Etsy or a wedding portal on the Knot, to just about content in any course management system, and so on. Individuals who are not necessarily technically trained are putting a lot of content on the web. School volunteers uploading content of school menus, for example. This has created a logarithmic rise of people to reach and teach, and we have been unable to catch up. And then she continued, at the same time that the web was becoming easier for non-technical folks to post content, the web itself was becoming more technically challenging for web designers and developers. We now need folks that understand complex dynamic markup, it's not me, and fully understand the way that barriers for those with disabilities get innocently put into place. Web professionals need performance-based training, plain and simple, and only a few of them are getting it. This ubiquity of which she speaks adds urgency to our notion that we must find a way to make accessibility part of the conversation in a way it has not yet been. I spoke to an employee of a tech company who in turn spoke of the need for corporate leadership. Now, I agree, leadership is important, but leadership changes. I mean, we've all seen the ebbs and flows at Apple, at Microsoft, that come and go when personnel changes. And at all events, let me ask, why would a corporate leader be schooled in what it means to lead an accessible company? Has the disability community been clear enough about what accessible company means? And where is the roadmap to tell them what to do? I don't mean put meaningful alt tags on images. I mean things like make sure all your customer interfaces are accessible. Leadership alone is not enough. Some of you may have heard Peter Wallach years ago at an earlier CSUN conference say that he thought when he got a video on accessibility from Larry Ellison, it was problem solved. And then he found out that the people who do the coding at Oracle report to someone who reports to someone who doesn't report to Larry Ellison, has a deadline, and accessibility be damned, the new product has to get out. So between turnover at the top and the distance to the bottom, policies and procedures on accessibility are a more certain guarantee than good leadership and good character, though we need that too. That tech company executive also spoke of company culture and making accessibility part of the conversation for everything from product development to supply chain. The supply chain issue is critical, and therein lies the makings of a great idea of how to make accessibility viral. But do we want the company to be the sole source of what the steps should look like to get there and what the goal line looks like? I spoke to another accessibility specialist at another tech company who said to attract and keep the best and brightest doing accessibility, the work needs to be recognized within the company in many ways, including pay. If the recognition and the big salaries are in AI, who wants to be knocking themselves out on accessibility? The same employee suggested using outside vendors to validate and test accessibility of software, she distinguished that from the accessibility of the content, has proven to be of little or negative value, and that QA for accessibility must equal what a company does for QA to check privacy and security. The better pay for accessibility folks and the higher quality accessibility checks will come, I suggest, with increased market demand, which I will suggest shortly may come if we're clearer about our non-technical expectations. Before turning to my analysis and suggestions, I want to turn to where one must always turn, to an analysis by a disability rights activist with a disability. He said, "You asked, why aren't we done yet? The answer to that question has a lot to do with the evolution of disability in our society. In 1985, when CSUN began, disability was not a common image or conversation in the places where important things were discussed. When it was a topic of conversation, it was about how do you accommodate, how do you modify so that people with disabilities might participate. The assumption was that the world is built in a certain way, and then we change it for the disabled. That model doesn't work with tech." He continued, "CSUN has the accessibility experts, but where are the power brokers in the tech industry? Instead of Dan Goldstein giving the keynote," I thought he was my friend, CSUN needs the CEO from Oracle, Google, Microsoft, Dell, GoDaddy," really, GoDaddy? "or any other major technology company to give a keynote about the value of accessibility." He continued, "And you asked, so what do we need to do? Our best accessibility experts need to build ways to train more people on accessibility best practices and techniques." And I would add some good news I learned yesterday is the accessibility checker for EPUB from DAISY that George Kirscher is going to be discussing at this conference, one of my heroes. Accessibility, he went on to say, needs to be deep in the computer science curriculum. People with disabilities need to be acknowledged as the benchmark for effective equal access. We need to establish mechanisms for weeding out the bad players. If a company has a VPAT that is clearly not a reflection of the product performance, what can you do about it? We need a crowdsourced place to aggregate information about the accessibility of products. We need new tools for those making procurement decisions to discover information about what the users say about accessibility. An editorial comment from me on this. The Tennessee State University system has required software developers to self-report in more detail than VPATs. State what accessibility barriers they will address and when, and then they put this up on the TSU website. That website needs to be visited and added to as much as possible. Back to what the activist said. Accessibility has to be out in the cool spaces. Accessibility needs to be talked about. We need products to start competing on accessibility. By the way, he asks, have you ever noticed any of these companies putting accessibility as the first feature of their product? It's almost always the last, if it's on the list at all, packed away with the VPAT. Instead, he says, tech companies focus their marketing energy on using their expertise to build specialized products. Microsoft and Google are working on navigation devices. Meanwhile, federal employees can't use SharePoint. Thousands of people with disabilities have downloaded Microsoft's Seeing AI app, but those same people can't use the Edge browser. To this, I, the speaker, say that Google Docs until recently and any employer using a pre-2016 version of SharePoint have had a devastating effect on the employment experience of blind people, and one that will continue to have an extremely serious impact for decades after both software programs are fully accessible wherever they're used, particularly in federal, state, and municipal employment, the places where blind people have at least had some success in getting jobs. And the reason I say it will continue is that someone going into one of those positions today who's blind will not see older mentors in responsible positions, because they're sitting by the wayside doing nothing as long as those programs are inaccessible. This means we need to understand why these programs were initially released as inaccessible programs if we're going to make real progress. And a lot of people are going to be unhappy when I say this. Google and Microsoft did the rational thing. The employment market was not enforcing requirements that workplace software be accessible. And given the development process that was particularly each one of those, there would have been significant delays to making them accessible. Time that would have been used by other companies to grab the market with similarly inaccessible software. We like to say that accessibility is good business, so we can't suddenly change our tune when accessibility is bad business. Instead, we need to break the cycle so that vendors lose out when they introduce inaccessible software. Here is my suggestion on how to do that. If I called your employer today and said, I would like you to be an accessible company, a rational response would be, what do you mean by that? Sure, we have technical standards, WCAG 2.0 and 2.1 and Section 508, accessible EPUB 3, BBC standards, and on and counting. But what does it mean to be an accessible company? It's a fair question, and it's not answered by technical standards alone. We need to articulate our expectations of what is an accessible company. And with that, we should articulate a pledge for companies to sign on to if they're prepared to strive to be accessible companies. And we need an available pool of guidance on how to implement those practices. So three parts: define accessible company, secure pledges, and give guidance. What would the standard look like? This is my initial shot that I hope all of you end up modifying and beautifying and everything else. First, the company must ensure that its outward-facing interfaces are accessible. That may be the company's website, its videos, its apps, point-of-sale machines, or kiosks, or all of the above. And this expectation would apply as much to Walmart, Applebee's, the Social Security Administration, Medicare, Kankakee State University, if there is such an institution, as it would to Apple. I'm not a techie, so when I say interfaces, I intend to include also the content that passes through those interfaces must be accessible. Outward-facing interfaces means that employee communications to persons outside the company, to persons outside the company. Do your employees know as a standard matter, never, ever, ever, ever send an image PDF? If I had a nickel for every time the NFB got a letter back from a company that had said, you're inaccessible, where they said, no, we're not, and sent it to the president of the NFB as an image PDF. But what if the company is on occasion a middleman offering someone else's technology, a Staples or an iPhone App Store or Google Play? I suggest to you that an accessible company that offers someone else's technology must provide information about the accessibility of that technology to the consumer or the end buyer. You can't judge an app by its cover, and the seller must tell you the extent, if any, that the app is accessible. What is the expectation of accessibility for a company that licenses authoring software? WordPress, Drupal, Wix, GoDaddy, or as a course management software or a database software licensor? Our standard would say that it is their responsibility to make it easy for customers to make accessible websites, hard to make inaccessible websites, easy to post accessible content on a course management system, and hard to post inaccessible content. And if a company certifies individuals or companies that adapt its products for the ultimate consumer, think, for example, Oracle certification for adapting its call center software, then certification must include training in how to use Oracle tools to preserve the accessibility that Oracle built in. I went today back to Oracle University's website to see if I searched for accessibility, what I would find. And I saw no certification containing your search terms were found. They put all this work into making the product accessible, and then they turn it over to people who don't know what to do with it. And then I end up having to sue the municipality or whoever it was for having an inaccessible call center that couldn't hire blind people. That doesn't make any sense. Second, the company must look inward. Is the software and other technology that your employees use accessible? Whether it's SharePoint, whether it's the flatbed scanner, whether it's the time and billing database or accounting software. You may have guessed, but this is the transformative piece, the one that gets us to the promised land. Jenny Lafleury tells me that Microsoft has more than 100,000 vendors and is looking at its supply chain for accessibility. Think about that for a minute. If we added to that Sony, JP Morgan Chase, Walmart, the Mayo Clinic, the Cal State System, and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and got them all committed to employee-facing accessible software, wouldn't that be game over? I mean, sure, there's overlap among those vendors, but think about how many vendors that is. It would then be economic suicide to produce inaccessible software. Accessibility would, you should pardon the expression, go viral. CSUN could then be an occasion for getting together to do some serious drinking and reminiscing about the bad old days. By the way, anybody wants to talk to me afterwards, I drink scotch. This inward looking has to include assessment tests, interview formats, caption training videos, accessible shuttles at company meetings, and so on. I mean, in this speech, I've mostly put it in terms of blindness because that's what I know. But this is something that applies very much cross disability. What I've just described is a mental first draft of a standard to be modified, corrected, and elaborated by the people in this room. There are companies out there who truly would like to know what we expect of them, and we owe it to them to tell them that. A document of this sort, issued perhaps by a trade group, would be enormously helpful to those who in turn are hired, people in this room who are hired to advise companies. There should be certification at different levels, like LEED, gold, platinum, silver, gold, silver. I mentioned we should have a pledge, and it can't be a pledge to reach the promised land tomorrow, because that ain't gonna happen. Nor can it be too vague. It must have time-limited escape clauses and obligations that address the transitional circumstances where the company doesn't have an accessible choice on the market. The pledge, however, should attract attention and assistance and provide a sense of accomplishment when certification is reached. A commercially reasonable pledge could be very valuable to companies. A potential vendor to Microsoft might convince Microsoft from the fact that it took the pledge that it should be in the supply chain. It might get a second look from the federal government customers if and when the federal government remembers that it's supposed to enforce 508. The company, yeah, I know, it's a little crazy. The company might even attract investment from mutual funds that specialize in investing in socially responsible companies. It would mean that disability rights groups and AHEAD and CSUN and others need to be ready with events and plaques that acknowledge and reward pledgees. And we must be there to record the economic success stories that result from being an accessible company. Finally, we must be ready to pitch in with resources, with user testing by persons with disabilities, and case studies of what does and doesn't work. And when there's a sample, for example, of what language to use in a contract to warrant and indemnify that you really are going to supply accessible software, that should go up online so that the company doesn't have to waste money paying lawyers like me to reinvent the wheel. This isn't a complete answer. Actually, I'm a former lawyer now, but this isn't a complete answer, but I suggest that pledging by a few major companies would sharply stimulate market demand among its suppliers and stimulate more than one or two colleges to offer classes in accessibility, and maybe even deter a few businesses from using GoDaddy to build their websites. Maybe what I suggest is wrong, but let's agree to figure out together how can we make accessibility endemic faster than technology develops. Until we get to the promised land of accessibility as a universal feature that occasionally needs tinkering as a new technology develops. I want to express deep appreciation to CSUN for inviting me to speak. Perhaps by now that invitation is regretted, but I have relished offering my thoughts on how we can stamp this completed. And more important, I look forward to hearing your thoughts on how we can get there. Thank you.
On behalf of CSUN, we really want to thank you, Dan. I think you've given us a lot to think about. So a little plaque for you. Now that you're retired, you can start collecting plaques. So.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was great.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have a couple of awards that we're going to announce, and I'd like to invite up Dr. Harry Murphy, who founded this conference 33 years ago, to present the awards.
My name is Harry Murphy, and I'm a graduate of CSUN. A bit about Fred Strache and a bit about the recipient of the Strache Award, Dr. Ladner. Fred Strache was the Vice President of Student Affairs at CSUN for many years. Now, this is not a eulogy. Fred's still around. And he was here 3 years ago to present the Fred Strache Award to another recipient. Fred is based in London because his wife is the head of the Pepperdine University study abroad in London, and then he also divides his time between Malibu and Honolulu. Tough life. One of his roles was to administer the student leadership groups at the university. And he loved doing that because he loved all students. But he had a special place in his heart for diversity and for any student who was considered to be a, quote, non-traditional student. He loved them. He was not a person who used I a lot. He liked we better. And he walked the walk and he talked the talk. He did not administer from some textbook in administration. He administered from the heart. He was a country boy from Kentucky, and he exuded a basic humanness, a basic and sincere love of others. If I'm the founder of this conference, he is the father. By that I mean, in order to start the conference and commit human and financial resources at the very beginning, I needed a go from higher administration. And in my case, that was Fred, who was my boss. He was enthusiastic about starting this conference. I think more than anyone, he had the vision of how this conference could help thousands of people, and over 33 years, tens of thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands. If anybody understood that, it was Fred. One time during Fred's time and mine at the university, the students, including the head of the student leadership group, had a sit-in at the university. And they were protesting, I forget what it was, they were protesting something that they didn't like. And so they had a sit-in. And it was absolutely hilarious because most of the administrators were products of the 60s. And they knew something about sit-ins because most of them had organized better sit-ins than these kids were doing. And in fact, Fred was critical of the, oh my God, look what they're doing. That's not the right way to do it. This is what they should be doing. And so he gave them some tips on how to protest the administration, which included himself. So could we have picked really a better person and a better role model for our leadership award? Okay, a bit about Richard Ladner, but I need to start with a story because in 1966, I was a teacher at the Pennsylvania School for the Deaf in Philadelphia. And I went out to Ball State University in Muncie, Indiana for a summer workshop. And the objective of the workshop was to review educational films and then make recommendations on which of those might be captioned for showing in schools that served deaf children. There were 40 participants, 20 of whom were deaf. And I became very friendly with a very nice couple, both of whom were teachers at the California School for the Deaf, located in Berkeley at that time. And their names were Mary and Emil Ladner, the parents of Richard Ladner. The next year I moved to California. I kept in touch with Mary and Emil. And the next year I moved to California and had been in touch with them and I was in LA and was going to make a short trip, vacation trip up to San Francisco. And they invited us to stay with them, my wife and I, and a three-year-old daughter. And they suggested one night that we have a night out on the town. And they would babysit my three-year-old daughter. So for more than 50 years, Richard, that act of kindness has always been in my heart and on my mind. And I get to repay them in a small way by introducing their son, Richard, as the recipient of this award at this conference. Okay, now some nuts and bolts. Dr. Ladner is Professor Emeritus at the Paul G. Allen School of Computer Science and Engineering at the University of Washington, where he has been on the faculty since 1971. His principal research area is in creating and evaluating technologies to help make the lives of people with disabilities better. He is currently working on the development of an accessible block-based programming language for touchscreen tablet computers so that blind children can have early access to computer programming. Dr. Ladner is the recipient of numerous awards and honors, including the 2004 Presidential Award for Excellence in Science, Math, and Engineering Mentoring, PAESMEN, my notes say, and the 2016 ACM SIG Access Award for Outstanding Contributions to Computing and Accessibility. Dr. Ladner served on the Gallaudet University Board of Trustees from 2007 to 2016. Ladies and gentlemen, the recipient of the Strache Award for 2018, Dr. Richard Allen.
Harry, I had not heard that story before. My parents babysitting your child, wonderful. I'm really honored by receiving the Strache Award. I'm really humbled by all the people who have received the award before me. I think the award started in 1988, so this would be the 31st award. I want to thank my parents, Emil and Mary, wherever you are. They taught me about disability, and they were deaf, but they never were negative. They didn't think about barriers. They didn't feel they were handicapped, but instead they viewed it as kind of an opportunity. And that's kind of in my heart now. Because both my parents had a strong connection with CSUN itself. After my father retired in 1971, he came down to CSUN to get a master's degree in the National Leadership Training Program. And with that master's degree, he continued to work after his age 60. So he retired from the School for the Deaf and actually led the RID for a couple of years. So thank you, Mary and Emil. I also want to thank my colleagues at the University of Washington, especially Cheryl Burkstahler, who is a 2012 winner of the Strache Leadership Award, for her support and guidance over the years. I want to thank my many students who have inspired me in many ways to create the next generation of accessible technologies. I'm really proud of two of my students, Sean Kane and Shiri Azenkot, both who have significant disabilities. And they're both professors, one at the University of Colorado and the other one at Cornell Tech in New York City. Finally, I want to thank my wife and my daughters for their continuing support. My youngest daughter sort of followed in my footsteps a bit. She's in her second year as an occupational therapist, working primarily with people with mobility-related disabilities. So I'm actually learning a lot from her because I don't know much about mobility-related disabilities. So again, thank you very much for this wonderful award.
Present you with this as a memento of this occasion, and thank you once again for your long service to the field, and congratulations on receiving this award.
Thank you very much.
I have an announcement concerning a journal on technology and persons with disabilities. And the announcement is as follows, quote, "We want to remind you that a preview PDF draft of the 2018 Journal on Technology and Persons with Disabilities is available for download. The research manuscripts are now available at the conference prior to publication for reviewing at the sessions. Remember, this preview version of the journal is a pre-published draft and should not be used as a reference or cited. We're on track to publish in the spring. So a big thank you goes out to the editorial team headed by Dr. Klaus Miesenberger from Austria, the journal program chair. Now at this time for another award, the Art Karshmer Research Award, I would like to introduce Dr. Miesenberger and also Dr. Judy Karshmer to give that award.
So on behalf of my husband, Art Karshmer, who was very much connected with the work of assistive technology, who loved this conference, and actually when he came, I think they did do a lot of the beer drinking that you were talking about. This was the love of his of research. It was the people that he met here. It was the impact that he felt he could have that has been so warm in my heart since his passing 2 years ago. I'm so honored to be here. On behalf of our children, Ilan and Avi, I'm so pleased to be here. And thank you, CSUN, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the passing of my dear friend, mentor, teacher and colleague Art Karshmer was not only a personal loss to many people, and for sure for many people in this room, but also a great loss for the field of assistive technology. We lost an outstanding and passionate teacher in computer science and a respected researcher in accessibility for people with disabilities. Access to math was his passion, and his contributions are still on our mind. As an advisory council member, both Art and I campaigned and argued to create a conference journal to increase the participation of science and research community to this conference, the one and only really networking conference in science and research has to be here. Art and I were proud that this was really a success from the first conference onward. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, please spread the word. There is a scientific journal, and we would be happy to increase the number of submissions to be more selective and really to drive the journal to one of the best. Spread the word and submit your fine science and research work. Through the Dr. Arthur Karshmer Award for Assistive Technology Research, we recognize Art's legacy and leadership in the field. This new annual award goes to the authors or to the author of the best submission to the journal track of the CSUN AT conference. Award winners are recognized for their exemplary submission and excellence in research and the advancement of assistive technology. It is this award that we honor Dr. Karshmer's extensive experience, commitment, and passion in our field, and to continue his legacy of innovative research improving the quality of life of people with disabilities. The scientific track accepts the best papers only. This award honors the best of the best. This year's 2018 and the first Dr. Arthur Karshmer Award for AT research goes to SETT Framework Modeler and PODD AAC Intervention in Elementary Grades, authored by Samuel Sennett from Portland State University, Alicia Chavez and Hannah Goldberg from Portland Public School District, and Jess Theobald from Nauset Public Schools. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Okay, before we close and move out to the reception, I'd like to acknowledge and thank our major sponsors for this conference. Without their support, we wouldn't be able to offer you the depth and the breadth of exhibits, presentations, and other events this conference is known for. So our sponsors include Accenture, Adobe, Amazon, AT&T, Capital One, Cox, DQ, Google, Level Access, Microsoft, Oracle, Site Improve, and VFO. We have a round of applause for our sponsors. So we'd like to ask everybody to go ahead and exit. We're going to be taking a few photos up here. So if you want to talk to anybody, wait till we get done with the photos. So go ahead and exit to the back. We'll join you at the reception shortly. Enjoy the conference.